bats are fascinating animals, and that extends also to their sensory arrays, which is what I study. They have this very famous, very special sense, which is echolocation. So basically they produce sound and they hear the echoes that come back to their ears, and by that they can build a quote-unquote mental image of the environment. Individual bats from the same species or the same group will have personally identifiable design for the signal, for the echolocation signal. Even when you measure them over months, you will see that I can, by the recordings, identify that this guy is bat number one and that guy is bat number eight. I'm trying to figure out if this sensory individuality, if it translates also to differences in how they utilize their environment. So I have this standardized task that they all have to perform, which is flying through this tunnel. In this tunnel, when they fly, I record their echolocation signals. Basically, I measure several parameters, if it's temporal interval or duration or frequency. The second part of this experiment is in this nice large flight chamber that we have here. We put half the area filled with trees and the other half empty, so it is simulating an open air environment versus a sparsely wooded environment, and then we just let the bats fly and we record them and we measure how long they spend in the wooded area versus how long they spend in the open area. And what we hope to find is that the same individuals that constantly use signal design that is better adapted for more cluttered environment also spend more time relative to the other ones in the cluttered environment, and that will provide us with support to our hypothesis that this is a sensory mechanism to reduce competition. Knowledge is valuable by itself, but this specific project also has some very real-world consequences. It gives us better understanding on how large populations of animals can survive in a given area that has inherently limited resources. When we plan conservation policies, then we don't just look at the species we want to conserve and say, well, the book says that this is an open air species, so we are going to preserve an environment that has open air. But if we know that individuals within that species also utilize the wooded area and that contributes to the survival of this population, then we know that we need to also conserve adjacent wooded areas to that open areas that we are conserving to make sure that there is stability for that population. So this is very important for conservation policy planning.